Hello everyone, in this video we'll discuss about balancing of inline engines. Inline engines, as the name suggests, are the type of engines in which the cylinders are placed in one row or in a single straight line. And they having no offset means that all the cylinders are identical, the gap between all the cylinders is same, and each cylinder, it drives their crankshaft, and the movement of all the crankshaft in turn, they move a single unit, which may be a rotor or any other system. Now the number of cylinders, it says all these cylinders, so the number of cylinders may vary depending upon the requirement. So number of cylinders can be 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 or 8 cylinders, right, depending upon the requirement. Plus in inline engines, because all the cylinders are placed in a straight line, they are also called as the straight engines. So they are used in cars, vehicles, medium heavy commercial vehicles, and lot of vehicles they are being used. Now, what we have to do? We have to do the balancing of inline engines. We are saying that in inline engines, there are n number of cylinders that are placed in a straight line back to back. So the arrangement is usually made in such a way that the unbalanced force produced by an individual cylinder is balanced by some other cylinder. That means the system as a whole, or the combination of all the cylinders placed as a whole, they are set up in such a way that the resultant or the output unbalanced force produced because of them is zero. Individually they will be producing imbalance, but they are producing imbalance in such a way that they are counterbalancing the imbalance, and the resultant of imbalanced forces plus is zero, and it is also preferable, and it is also tried during the arrangement or the design, that the resultant couple should also be zero. That means the system should be dynamically stable. Now we have already discussed this, that while balancing the reciprocating parts, we usually place certain mass at the crank pin, right, and which produces a centrifugal force, and the horizontal component of this mass, it balances the unbalanced force produced because of the inertia effect of reciprocating masses. Now we have also derived this equation, that the total unbalanced force is produced is mr omega square cos theta plus mr omega square upon n cos 2 theta, where theta is what, the angle made by the crank with the line of the stroke, r is the length of the crank, omega is the angular speed, and mass is the m, or the mass of the point body which is attached for balancing. So the mass at the crank pin is denoted as small m. So what we can say, that if I assume that there are actually two systems, there are actually two cranks running in the system, this be the actual crank and this be the imaginary crank. So what can I say from these two formulas? I can say, if the angular velocity of the actual crank is omega, then the angular velocity of the imaginary crank, or we can say imaginary crank is producing the secondary force, it will be 2 omega, right? Because I know the formula for imbalanced force, so the inertia is mr omega square cos theta. So if I say that the length of crank is r in case of the actual crank, for imaginary crank it is r upon 4n, and the mass of the crank pin is the same. So if we place these values of imaginary crank in the formula of mr omega square cos theta, what we get in return is mr omega square upon n cos 2 theta. So we can say that if any system which is having the mass m at the crank pin, and it makes an angle theta and moves with angular velocity omega, it produces the primary force, then the similar mass when it rotates with the angular velocity of 2 omega, that means double the angular velocity of the actual crank or the primary force producing crank, and it makes the double the angle of the angle produced by the crank in the actual crank, then we can say that this imaginary system, it produces the secondary force. So what is the difference? The angle is doubled, and the angular speed is also, angular velocity is also doubled, that will produce the secondary force, and these are the values, that is omega r and m, for the primary unbalanced force. Now if we see, this is the isometric view where all the cylinders are identical. The gap between them is same in or for all the cylinders, right? The gap is same, and each cylinder is driving its own crankshaft, which in turn is driving any common system, which may be a rotor or anything like that, right? So what happens at any one particular instant, one cylinder gets fired. So let's say if one gets fired at the one particular instant, let's say when the theta is zero or when the angle is some value theta. So what will happen? The positions of all the other cylinders will be as per the cycle. I mean, the what is happening, the firing angle or the firing position of all the cylinders is fixed depending upon what type of engine it is, whether it is two stroke or four stroke, and the number of cylinders which are being used. So if this cylinder one is fired once, the position of two will be somewhat lower than that, three will be lower than that, and when the position, let's say when the turn for two for getting fired comes, so it goes to the top and the others, they change their position. So basically what is happening, the motion, the firing is done for an individual cylinder at one single time. So if we see at this diagram, so it says that if for n number of cylinders the firing is to be done in one complete cycle or for particular root number of rotations of crank, so what will be the theta? It will be 2 pi upon n. N is the number of cylinders, right? For 2 stroke and for 4 stroke, it is 4 pi upon n, where n is the number of cylinders. So these lines are showing the cylinder center lines, and whatever couples we'll talk about the engine center line, right? Engine center axis. So if we look in this diagram, what we have done is, we are not using the isometric views while doing the analysis, rather we are using the engineering drawings. So what we are doing, we are making the cylinder centers for all the cylinders. So these red lines, these are the cylinder centers for 1, 2, 3 and 4. And what we said, the distance between all the cylinder centers or the axis of cylinder is same. So let's say the distance is L, L and L for all the three cases. And what the green line is showing, it is actually showing the engine center line or the axis, center axis of engine. So if this distance is L, this will be L by 2 and L by 2. Now to find out what will be the positions at which the cylinders will be fired, the angle, to find the angle, it is 2 pi upon n, right? And because it is a two stroke engine, right, we are talking about two stroke and four cylinder engine, so 2 pi by 4, which is pi by 2. That means if I assume that the first cylinder is getting fired at 0 degree and whatever the rotation, it may be clockwise or anti-clockwise, so the second engine will get fired at 90 degree, so it will be theta plus 90. So theta is 0, then theta plus 90 is 90, then again 90 plus 90, the angle which is the, like the successive angles will be plus 90, so 90 plus pi by 2 or 90, it will be 180 degree, then again plus 90, it will be 270 degree, and after that again we'll come back to the engine, come back to the cylinder one, so 270 plus 90, it will again be 360 degree or 0 degree, right? It is one and the same thing. So this is how the firing takes place. So this is how we decide or find the angle at which all the cylinders are placed in such a way that the firing, it takes place uniformly for the system. Let's take the example of two stroke and two cylinder engine. So what is the distance? It is L and L. And if there are two stroke, two cylinder, so it is 2 pi by 2, that is pi. So the first engine is fired, if we say that theta is 0 degree, the other is getting fired at 180 degree, then again 360, or you can say 0, 180, 0, 180. So this is how the cycle goes on. For four stroke, four cylinder engine, so we have got the four cylinder axis, 1, 2, 3, and 4, and again the distance between all of them is same, so 4 stroke means 4 pi, and number of cylinders is 4, so it is 4 pi by 4. That means after every pi degree, after every 180 degree, the engine will get fired. And because the cycle is of two crank rotations, right? So if we say that the initial position at which the cylinder gets fired is 0 degree. So if 1 is 0 degree, 2 will be 180 degree, then 3 will be again 360 degree, or you can say 0 degree, and 4 will be again 180 degree. Similarly, for 4-stroke 6-cylinder engines, that means there are 6 cylinders. So we have got the 6-cylinder axis 1, 2, 3 and 4, 5, 6, right? And because all the cylinders are in single line, all the cylinders, their dimensions, their geometry is same, the gap between them is same. Therefore, the center of the engine, it always lies at the center of the arrangement of the cylinder. So it is always the cylindrical axis of the whole system, right? So 4 pi and the number of cylinders is 6, so it becomes 4 pi by 6, 2 pi by 3, that is 120 degree. That means after every 120 degree, a new cylinder or the next cylinder will be fired. So if one, for a cylinder 1, theta is 0 degree, so 2 will be 120 degree, then 3 will be 240 degree, then again the next one will, 4 will come to again 0 degree. So basically it is happening like this. For one rotation it is this, and for the second rotation again the chain starts like this. So whether you say it is 360 degree or 0 degree, it will not make much difference. It is giving the same values for whatever, you know, angles you take, like cos or sine or whatever it is. So basically it is telling the same position of the crank, but yes, the angle will be different even though the values are same, because it is talking about the first rotation and the second rotation. So we take it from the initial position, it becomes 0 degree and 360 degree and so on. So now we know how the positions of the cylinders are decided, how we decide the timing or the angle at which a particular cylinder is fired. Now we'll do the analysis, the balancing of various arrangements. So first let us take the case of a 2-stroke 4-cylinder engine. So 2-stroke means 2 pi and 4-cylinder means divide by 4. So for every pi by 2 or for every 90 degree, the engine will be, or a new cylinder will be fired. So if we are saying that the positioning, the firing sequence, now see, the firing sequence can also be changed. So whenever you are doing the analysis, you have to keep in mind what firing sequence are you taking. So let's say I'm taking the firing sequence 1, 2, 3 and 4. So 1, then the next will be 2 after 90 degree. So in books you will see it is theta plus 90. So for convenience we are taking theta as 0 degree, then it will be 0 plus 90, then plus 90 and plus 90. So this is how we are placing all the four cylinders, because we have to keep in mind that it has to be a symmetric, or we can say a uniformly distributed system over the rotation of crank, right? Now, these are the cylinder center lines, and this green line is showing the center of the engine, right? Now, we already know that there are two types of unbalanced forces produced in the system. One is the primary force and the other one is the secondary force. And because of primary forces, we have the primary couples and the secondary couples as well. So we'll do both the methods. We'll solve them vector by using the vector diagrams and also by analytical method. So primary forces, now see, the position of one is this, right? So force F1 will be applied in this direction, in the direction of the cylinder, along the line of cylinder. If you remember the diagram of a slider crank mechanism, right? The unbalanced force is along the line of stroke, right? So the first will be F1 in this direction. Now F2, so after firing the cylinder 1, the next is F2. So F2, what is the position of this F2? It will be after 90 degree rotation of the crank. So now the crank will be rotated by 90 degrees. So along the line of stroke will be this F2, right? Now again, you're moving 90 degree from this cylinder 2. So it will be this position. So F3 will be in this direction. The line of stroke will keep on changing because the crank is rotating continuously, right? And for F4, this is this position. And please do keep in mind that the crank of each connecting rod is different. they are moving their own individual crankshafts. So the position of the cranks are changing, so the direction of forces are changing. So we see this is a closed polygon, that means the primary forces are balanced. You can check it analytically. Mr omega square cos theta is the primary force, m or the mass of the reciprocating part or the mass you're putting at the crank pin basically to balance the reciprocating parts is same for the whole system. R is the length of the crank, which is same for all the cylinders, and omega is same. So mr omega square cos theta, so 0 degree, 90 degree, 180 degree and 270 degree, right? So the answer is 0, right? Because 0 is 1, 180 is minus 1, 90 and 270, they are 0. So the answer we get is 0. Now we talk about the primary couple. How do we calculate the couple? Couple basically, while drawing the couple polygon, we usually use the right hand screw rule or the curl rule, where the direction of curls, it gives the direction of the couple, and the thumb, it is showing the direction of the torque, right? So thumb is showing the direction of torque and the curl of the fingers or the is showing the direction of the rotation. So actually what should happen, the couple diagram, the vector should be perpendicular to that of the force. But in earlier discussions we have already said this, that to omit any kind of confusion, what we are doing, we are taking the couple vectors in the direction of the force only. So we are basically rotating all the couple vectors 90 degree. So if you are rotating all the couples, it won't make much difference to the system. So you can use both the ways. Either you can draw the couple or the moment vector 90 degree or perpendicular to the force, or you can draw it parallel to the force. The magnitude should be correct and the direction for all the couples should be taken in same way, right? So what we are doing, we are taking the couple parallel to the force. So this is, now what is it? We are taking the couple from this axis, right, which is the center of the engine. So it will be for F1, F1 is in this direction. So couple basically it should be 90 degree from this, but we are taking in the same direction. We are rotating the whole couple, this polygon, by 90 degree. So it will come something like this. So this is F1 into L, because into this distance, right, which is 3L by 2. Then for second, it is in this direction. So this is 2, which is F2 into the distance, which is L by 2. Then, because we are taking it from the central axis, so for the third cylinder, it will be MR omega square, like F3 into minus L by 2. So it will be in the opposite direction. So 3 is here. So it will be in the direction opposite to that of the F3. The axis will remain the same. It will be parallel to 3, but in the direction opposite to the direction of the force vector. And again F4, because we are taking this distance as negative, so it will be in this direction opposite to F4. So this is, the magnitude is basically F4 into this distance, which is 3L by 2. So if we look at this diagram, this is not a closed polygon. That means the system has unbalanced primary couple. If we solve it analytically, so it is MR omega square into L cos theta. So for the first one, it is 3L by 2, L plus L by 2, which is 3L by 2 cos 0 degree, plus for the second one, it is L by 2 cos 90 degree. For third one, it is minus L by 2 cos 180 degree, and fourth is minus 3L by 2 cos 70 degree. Now, because you see, if you're talking about the torques on this hand, they try to move the system in this direction, and on the other hand, they try to move the system or rotate the system in the reverse direction. So therefore we have to keep in mind that the signs should be changed. So the resultant that we get is 2mr omega square L. So it shows that in this system, by taking the sequence of firing as 1 2 3 4, the primary couple is not balanced. Now we see the secondary couple. Now we know secondary force is what, mr omega square upon n cos 2 theta, and we have already discussed in the beginning of the video that we can consider the secondary forces equal to like the force created because of an imaginary crank in such a way that its speed is double that of the crank the original crank, which is producing the primary force, and the angle produced, or the angle between the crank and line of stroke, is also doubled. So in this case, in secondary force, what will be the values? It will be 2 theta and 2 omega. So these are the changes that we'll make to the original equation. So if you look at this diagram to calculate the secondary forces, the first one is created for 2 theta. So first theta was 0 degree. So 2 into 0 will be 0 only. So F1 will be created in this direction only. Now F2 was initially being created, or F2 was being exerted in this direction, which was 90 degree to the first cylinder. So 2 theta is 90 into 2. So it becomes what? 180 degree. So the position of F2 is in this direction, which is at an angle 180 degree to F1. Now similarly for F3, originally for the actual crank position, for 3, theta is what? 180 degree. But twice of 2 theta becomes 360 degree. So it is in the direction of F1. Similarly, F4, right? F4 is at an angle 90 degree to 3. That is, it is at 270 degree. So rotating it into 540 degree. So it will again come at this place. It will share the same position as the 2. Right, so 2 and 4 will be in same direction, and 1 and 3 will be in the same direction, and they will form a closed, basically it is not forming a polygon, but it is showing that the forces, the unbalanced secondary forces, they are counterbalancing each other, and the resultant is 0. We can also check by placing the values in the equation. So it is mr omega square upon n, which is cos 2 theta, so 2 into 0, 2 into 90, 2 into 180, and 2 into 270. So the answer we get is 0. Now the secondary couple. Now again the couple, it will be the force into the perpendicular distance. So F1 is in this direction, right? So F1 into this is 3L by 2, the perpendicular distance. So F1 into 3L by 2, it is in this direction. The direction, we are again keeping the direction of couple in the direction of force only. For 2, it is F2 into L by 2. So this is L by 2 in this direction, right? And cos 2 theta, of course. And for 3, the position is right in this direction, in the upward direction. But because we are taking all the moments from the center of the engine axis, it will be minus L by 2. So the direction of coupled because of the 3 or C3, it will be in this direction, the same direction as that of 2. And for the couple because of the force, cylinder will also have its direction opposite to that of the force, because it is F4 into minus 3L by 2. So the direction will be reversed, and we can see that we are not ending the diagram from where we started. That means the system has unbalanced secondary couple. You can also check it analytically, and we get the couple, the resultant couple, as 3mr omega square L upon N. Now if we try solving it for 4-stroke 4-cylinder engine, so we know for 4-cylinder engine it is theta is 4 pi upon 4, that means pi. So what will happen? The firing of a new cylinder, or firing of the next cylinder, or a successive cylinder will take place after every 180 degree. So if the position of firing of angle of cylinder 1 is 0 degree, so 2 will be fired at 180 degree, then so this is like this 180 degree, then again 360 degree, and this 540 degree, right? So but the positions of 1 and 3 are same, and the positions of 2 and 4 are same. Now again, the diagram is similar to what we have already discussed. These are the cylinder center lines, and this is the axis, right? The cylinder, the engine center axis, along which we'll take the couples, right? So the primary force, we know the force F1 is along this axis, right? So F1 will be along this axis, which is at angle 0 degree. In books, you'll see it is given theta plus theta plus 180. So to make it easy, we are saying that, okay, let's say theta is 0, and now we are making the changes. So F2 will be in the direction opposite to this, F3 will be in the same direction as F1, and F4 will be in the direction of F2. So if you solve it analytically, you'll see that primary forces are zero and we are getting a closed polygon. Now, if we talk about the primary couple, it is what the force mr omega square cos theta into the distance, which is this distance 3L by 2 plus, and this is for 0 degree. The second force is what mr omega square cos 180 degree into this distance, which is L by 2. Now, because the moments produced on the right hand side of this central axis will be in this direction, so the distance that we take, they become negative. So it will be minus this distance L by 2 into mr omega square cos, the third, for third it is angle is 360 degree, minus what is the distance for the fourth cylinder, it is 3L by 2 into cos 540 degree. So of course they are not cancelling out each other and we get certain value, which is the unbalanced primary couple. You can also see it from the vector diagram, the position of 1 and 2 are same as along the forces, but the magnitudes are of course different because the distance of the cylinder from the central axis is different for 1 and 2. And for 3 and 4 cylinders, the direction of couples are opposite to that of the forces. Right, so we are not getting a balanced primary couple. Now for the secondary forces, we know the secondary forces are being taken assuming that the angle is 2 theta and the speed is 2 omega. So the formula is mr omega square upon n cos 2 theta. So if you check it analytically, so cos 2 into theta, so first angle is 0 degree, then 180 degree, then 360 degree, and then 540 degree. So this is the unbalanced secondary force that we are getting. If we check it graphically, so 1 is in this direction, right? 0 into 2 will make it 0 only, right? So the position of 1 will be same. 2 is 180 into 2 becomes what? Again, 360 degree, or it comes to the excess of force 1 only. Now 3 is what? 3 is already lying here. So this is basically 0 into 2, it will be 0 only. So 3 will be at this position only. And 4, it is again on the line of this 180 degree. So 180 degree into 2 again will make it 360 degree and it will be in the same direction. So these secondary forces are getting added up and this is the resultant that we get. But now if you look at the secondary couple, so what is the secondary couple? The first one is in the direction of F1, and so it is F1 into 3L by 2. The second one is F2. So this is the direction of the secondary couple. So one is in the direction of force only into 3L by 2. Second is in the direction of F2 into L by 2. And for 3 and 4, their directions change because you're taking the all the values of the distances of the cylinder from the central axis on the right hand side of the axis. So it becomes minus 3L by 2 and minus L by 2. So analytically also we can check that it is 0. And here also we can see that coupled because of 1. C1 is counterbalancing C4 and C2 is counterbalancing C3. So the primary force and the secondary couple are balanced, but the primary couple and secondary force, these two values are unbalanced. Now we see how the whole thing changes, how the whole scenario changes if we change the sequence of firing of the system. Initially we were taking the sequence as 1, 2, 3, 4. If I change the sequence to 1, 2, 4, 3, so how will be the change? If I say this is the isometric diagram where 1 is at 0 degree, 2 is at 180 degree, right? 3 is at again the same position and 4 is in the same direction as that of the 1 cylinder, right? But we are changing the axis of, we are changing the sequence of firing. So it will be first, that means 0 degree, then 2, 180 degree, then 4, which is 360 degree or 0 degree, and 3, which will again be 180 degree. So let's see how the primary force changes. F1, this is the direction of F1, right? F2 is in this direction, so F2. Then the next, because it is 1, 2, 4, 3. So 4 is again in the direction of F1 and F3 is in the direction of F2. Even if we place the values of theta, we get that the primary force is 0 or the resultant is 0. Now we see for the primary couple. 1 is in the direction of force, which is mr omega square cos theta into 3l by 2. For 2, it is same as it was in before. So 2 is in this direction, right? The direction here, right? So 2 is at an angle 180 degree to the cylinder 1. So it is l by 2, the distance from the engine axis, l by 2 into cos 180 degree. Now the next one is 4, which is in the direction of 1. But the distance is taken as negative. So it becomes, this is the value, which is 3l by 2 into cos 360 degree. Because the position of 4 is this 3l by 2. Even though you are firing it before 3, but the position of 4 is after 3 only. So distance is minus 3l by 2 cos 360 degree. And for the fourth one in the sequence is the cylinder 3. So the distance of cylinder 3 is l by 2, but the angle it makes is 540 degree. So we get the resultant primary couple as 0. Now when we see the secondary forces, again by taking 2 theta and 2 omega value, we see that the secondary forces are not balanced. They are getting added up in this case also, even after changing the sequence of the firing, because 2 theta, that is 0 into 2 for cylinder 1. For 2, it is 180 into 2, that is again 360. So it is coming to the same axis of that of the cylinder 1, similarly for 4 and similarly for 3. But if we see the secondary couple, because of the chain in sequence, it is 1 in the direction of F1. 2 is in, will be in this direction, which is in the direction of, so 2 will be in this direction, if we see, in the opposite direction, because now the angle is changing, it's getting twice. So 2 initially was at 180 degree, but for secondary couple it will be 2 into 180, that means at the position of 360 degree. So the arrow for the vector will change. 4 was at this value of 360, so it is 360 into 2 at a distance of 3l by 2. And the fourth one in the sequence is the cylinder 3, which is at a distance of l by 2 into cos 540 degree into 2. So initially the position for 3 is 540, so it will be into 2. So we will see that all the values, they get cancelled out and the resultant we get is 0. So here we can see that just by changing the sequence of firing, the number of unbalances are being reduced. Now we'll see it for the 4-stroke 6-cylinder engines. Now here we have drawn the isometric diagram. So let's say cylinder 1. Now because there are 4-stroke and 6-cylinder, we have already discussed that the angle of firing for each successive cylinder will differ by 120 degree. So if the position of 1 is this, at 0 degree, 2 will be 120, 3 will be 240, and this is how the cycle will go on. So if we keep the sequence as 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, this is how the isometric diagram will look like. So it will be 1 will be 0. So 0 plus 120, that is 120, 240, and so on. But if, now we have already seen in case of the 4-stroke 4-cylinder engines that just by keeping the sequence as like the order of firing as 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, the imbalances are not balanced. So in this, we have directly changed the order of sequence or the order of firing of the cylinders, and we see how the primary forces, couples, and secondary forces and couples are balanced. So there may be many orders or many sequences that can be formulated. So in this case, we are taking the third order of firing, that is the second one, that is 1, 2, 3 and 6, 4, 5. You can try taking the other sequences and see what are the unbalanced forces or the couples that are left in the system. So these are the cylinder centers 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and 6, because the distance of all the cylinders is same. So the distance from 1 and 2 is L, 2 and 3 is L, and because this is the engine center, so this distance is L by 2, L by 2 and so on. So for the primary forces, now we have also seen the crank diagram. For 1, it is 0 degree, for 2 it is 120 degree, for 3 it is 240 degree. So the angle is going like this, 240 degree and then 360 degree, and this way this is going, right? So 1 and 4 coincide, 2 and 5 coincide, and 3 and 6 coincide. So if we draw the primary force diagram, here we have just drawn the primary force and the coupled diagrams and not done it analytically. So the axis of 1 is this axis, right? So this is the axis of 1. So F1 will be applied in this direction. So here you can see F1. F2 is in this position along this axis. So F2 is this, right? Similarly, F3, because the values of forces is mr omega square cos theta. So the direction of vector changes according to the angle of the crank position with the line of stroke. So for 3, if we see this along this line, so F3 is this. Then the sequence is 1, 2, 3, 6, 5, 4. So 6 is along this line only. So we'll extend it like this 6. And 5 is along with 2. So this 5 and this is 4. And we see this is a closed polygon. So the primary forces are balanced. Just by looking at the diagram also, you can understand that if we would have followed this sequence, there is a possibility that the forces might not be balanced. So if you go 1, 2, 3 and 4. Right, so 4 is along the direction of 3 only, 4, 5, 6. So you can try making these diagrams and see if they get balanced or not. So now for the primary couple. Couple is what? Force into the distance. So it is into perpendicular distance. So F1 into this distance, which is L plus L plus L by 2. So this is the direction of the couple because of 1. 2 is along the same direction as that of the force 2 and 3 is along the same direction as that of 3. Only the distances change. For cylinder 2, it is 3L by 2. For 3, it is L by 2. Right? Now, the sequence changes to after 1, 2, 3, it is 6. Now, see, 6 is along the line of 3, but because the direction of the length, the perpendicular distance from the engine center is negative and this is the distance, right? So it will be along the line of 3. So this is 6 in the direction opposite to that of the 3. Because you see the couple is being produced in this way and this is how they counterbalance each other. Now next is 5. So 5 is in the same axis as that of 2 but in the opposite direction. So this is 5 in the direction opposite to that of 2. And then we have got 4. Which is in the same line as 1 but in the opposite direction because the distance is being taken negative. So this is 4 and we see that all the primary couples are being balanced. Similarly for secondary force, we know the angle is twice that of the primary force and speed is also doubled, which is 2 omega. So if 1 is making angle 0, so 2 into 0 will be 0 only. So 1 will be along the same axis, right? 2, if it is at 120 degrees, so twice will be 240 degrees. So it will be along this axis of 3 and 6 along this line. So we'll have 2 along this line. Similarly for 3, if you do the double, it will come to the axis of 120 degrees. So this will be 3 and so on. You can do it for 6, 5 and 4. And we see that for secondary forces also, we get a closed polygon. That means the secondary forces are also balanced in the system. Similarly, we can do it for the secondary couple, which is secondary force into the perpendicular distance from the engine center axis. So the direction of 1 will remain same, right? Into this distance, which is 2L plus L by 2. Then for 2, it is the direction as per F2, which is this direction, right? So this direction into the distance, which is 3L by 2, then for 3, it is in the vector of couple is also in the direction of F3. So similarly, we can draw and we see that all the secondary couples are also balanced. So you can see that how the changing of the order of firing can bring about a change in the unbalanced forces and it can actually make the system completely balanced. Now, please keep in mind that the couples, the direction is actually perpendicular to that of the force, but for our convenience we have taken these directions parallel to the force, but because we have rotated the whole system by 90 degrees, we have rotated the whole couple polygon by 90 degrees, therefore it won't make any difference to the final or the resultant value of the couple that we are getting.